بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية أمير المؤمنين والأئمة المعصومين عليهم السلام، والحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، خاتم النبيين، شفيع المذنبين، حبيب الله العالمين، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يوم عداوتهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق القائلين: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أفلم يسيروا في الأرض فتكون لهم قلوب يعقلون بها أو آذان يسمعون بها؟ آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. I begin in the name of Allah, the most kind, the most merciful. It's due to His kindness and mercy that He gives us these opportunities where we gather in remembrance and glorification of Him, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And then we send our condolences to our 12th and living Imam, Al-Hujja Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. As we gather today to commemorate the wafat of Ummul Baneen, may our fathers and mothers be sacrificed for her, alayha afdalus salatu was salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Ummul Baneen goes by the name of Hazrat Fatima bint Hazm bin Khalid ibn Rabi ibn Amir al-Kalbi. And she comes from the tribe of Banu Kilab, which was famous, famously known for their nobility amongst the Hashimis. And they were specifically or more particularly known for their bravery. And history tells us that many years after the istishhad of Sayyida Fatima alayhi salam, Imam alayhi salam requested his brother Aqil to find him a bride from a tribe which is known for bravery. And Aqil, being an expert of sorts amongst the Arabs as far as tribal genealogy, he suggested the name of Fatima, or as we famously know as Ummul Baneen. It's interesting that why did the Imam alayhi salam request or have such a request? And then again, history tells us that approximately in the 8th year after Hijra, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, ma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, informed our first Imam alayhi salam that there will come a time when alongside his son Hussein, he will have other children. And in particular, one who will stand by him throughout. And therefore, this would be somebody who would be brave and be on his side. And the Imam alayhi salam knew that this was a foretold event that will happen. And thus he sought out somebody from amongst a family or a tribe that was brave, who would produce these brave children to be by his son's side. It's interesting. The date of the marriage of Ummul Baneen to our first Imam alayhi salam is not really given, or one particular mark is not given to say that this was definitely the year. But we can try and work backwards in a way, because we know that Abul Fadl was born in the 26th year after Hijra. And therefore the marriage of Ummul Baneen to the first Imam alayhi salam may have happened a year or a couple of years prior to that. And even if we say it happened on the 24th year after Hijra, that would mean that the second and the third Imam were approximately 20 or 21 years old when Abul Fadl was born. And you can see then that there was this age difference. And that's why even some narrations or some historians tell us that that one of the touching moments in Karbala was when Zainab alayhi salam recalled how she had raised Abu al-Fadl. And this was a very difficult moment for her to see somebody who she taught and she played with to go out and seek martyrdom. Umm al-Baneen gets the name from the four children that she had with the first Imam, Abbas, Abdullah, Ja'far, and Uthman. And she has been given this title of Umm al-Baneen, the mother of sons. And this is where she gets this title because of the four children. She is known for a lot of qualities. Some of the qualities that she is known for, naturally being from a tribe of brave and courageous people, is her courage. But more so, you find within her characteristics of loyalty, of self-sacrifice, of very high iman. And these are very beautifully seen in her children in Karbala, isn't it? That when we look at Abu al-Fadl, these are the exact same qualities that we see in him. Bravery, courage, loyalty, and iman. I think sometimes we forget to give Abbas alayhi salam the credit of high iman. You know, we say he's brave, he's patient. But this was a man who grew up in the house where Risala came down. He grew up understanding the position of imamat, and therefore that in itself elevates a person in their iman. One of the ways in which we honor Umm al-Baneen truly is when we go for the ziyarat of her children, including Aba Abdullah, to Karbala. Because it was her hard work and it was her self-sacrifice that raised children who were willing to sacrifice themselves for the cause of Islam. And this is where we're going to pause and then come back to her in the Masai. But this idea of ziyarat, I want to kind of go off onto a subject on its own. March break is coming up very soon, and this is a time generally when a lot of people go for ziyarat, either during the Easter holidays or during the March break time. And if some people can't make it for ziyarat, they take this March break opportunity to take a vacation with the family or sorts. So today I want to very briefly talk about what's known as adabu safar, the etiquettes of traveling. And when one travels on any journey, there are certain etiquettes that Islam has provided and set as guidelines that if one were to follow them, that entire journey would become ibadat. That's the beauty of Islam, you know, that you know, sometimes we feel that, oh, Allah mandates this and puts a limit on this and gives us, but really He gives us adab, etiquette of everything, yeah? There is adab of majlis. I'm not sure if I gave a lecture here on adab of majlis, meaning how to sit in a mosque and what is expected of you. You know, a little while ago, the Mukhi requested the people on this side of the hall to move, and mashallah, very few of you moved, you know? Because, you know, once you're sitting, you're comfortable, and for sure, the people on the walls will never move, yeah? But you know, there's a verse in the Quran, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, idha qila lakum tafassahu fil majalisi, fafsahu, yafsahillahu lakum. My favorite verses of the Quran, yeah? You know what God says? He says, O you who believe, if you are told to move in a gathering, move, God will move for you, yeah? Subhanallah, yeah? Subhanallah, yeah? God, yeah, who doesn't have to move for anybody. He says, when you are told to move, move. I will move for you. Yeah. So, you know, a humble advice, you know. When you're told to move, move. Yeah. The seat is not that comfortable. I know even if you're on the wall, just scoot over a little bit. Yeah. Just scoot over. You know, you say, God, look, I'm trying. I'm scooting over. Yeah. But do it, right? There's adab. There is etiquette involved in every single thing that happens in Islam, from the way we sit. I gave a three-part lecture in Masumin about the adab of sleeping, the etiquettes of going to sleep. There is etiquette of eating, etiquette of going to the washroom, etiquettes for everything. And the reason why God gives us these guidelines, right, in things which we would consider to be normal, if not mubah, permissible, but He gives us guidelines that if we were to follow, literally what happens, our entire existence becomes a form of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? That means even mundane tasks that we consider mundane, like walking, there is adab of mashi, right? Adab of Noam, all these things, every single second of my life becomes ibadat. And imagine how close a person becomes to God when they live this type of life. So I want to talk about the adab of safar, because I know I'll be traveling next week, and many of you, inshallah, will be traveling. And even if you're not traveling now, you will travel in the future. So there are 5 points, basically, and I want you to remember these 5 points, because they're not difficult. But inshallah, you will not just remember them, but apply them into your life. So salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. The first thing is that we have to understand that from an Islamic perspective, traveling for ziyarah or for any journey, and we'll talk about the type of journeys that is actually permissible in Islam, is highly recommended, right? One should travel. One shouldn't become stingy and never leave their house. Take your family out. Enjoy, even if it's for a drive, or if it's getting on a plane or getting on a train or whatever it is. Go out and travel. I know some of the travel agents here are going to be very happy with me, yeah? But hold your horses. You might not be after a while, yeah? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ Do they not travel in the lands? فَتَكُونَ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا For they will have hearts with which they will understand. Biha aw adhanun yasma'una biha. So he says, have they not traveled the land so that they should have hearts with which they understand or ears with which they hear? You know, traveling has a lot of benefits, right? From one perspective, when we go to places which are not as well off as us, right? We begin to see how other people live and appreciate the bounties that God has provided for us. And maybe through that, get inspired to assist those who are less fortunate than we are. Traveling helps us enrich our culture, right? We see how other cultures live. We don't become isolated, or we don't become ta'assub. We don't have this type of bigotry to think that we are the only ones who are doing it, and we're the only ones who are doing it right. Right? This was like a really an eye-opening experience. And now I know many people go for ziyarat, but when I went to Hawza, Iraq wasn't as open at that time, but people were still going. But to see how another culture does azadari was really eye-opening, right? The way they have their commemorations and then the way they do things, coming from a background where I had never gone and experienced these things, it was truly eye-opening, and it makes you appreciate the richness of what God has put on this earth. You see how other people live, and especially when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this as well, one aspect is to see how people who thought that they were very powerful, and when the azab of God came, they were completely wiped out from the face of this earth. So don't think that you're all that, when in reality, God is the ultimate master of everything. So we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this verse, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا, comes multiple times in the Quran. Have you not traveled, God says. And so you see that traveling is actually a recommendation in Islam. Go out, see the world, and take lessons from what you see. There's a hadith as well from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. صلي على محمد وآل محمد. He says, safiru, travel, safiru, tasihhu wa taghnamu, travel and you will be wealthy and healthy. Yeah? Interesting, right? Travel and you will be healthy and wealthy. Now I'll give my own personal story, right? So growing up, playing a lot of sports, I have knee issues, right? Yes, I was a baller at one time, yeah? Don't get it twisted. Having a lot of knee problems, right? So just generally, knee aches. But when I went for Hajj, it was remarkable. You know, in Hajj, you pray on that marble, you do sajda, you sit on that marble. And when I came back from Hajj, my knee pain, at least for a few months, until I started sitting on this plush carpet again, for a few months, my knee pain went away. And I was shocked at this, right? Because we walk so much in Hajj, and you do all of these things. But that actually helped me in what I want to do, right? And so you see that there is this component of healthiness, And obviously, if you take care of yourself, I know many of you are thinking, man, every time I come back from ziyarat, I have a cold. Yeah. Well, don't let that misunderstand what the hadith is saying, right? You become healthy and wealthy in numerous ways. You understand things that, for example, you pick up habits that different people have. Either you're going to apply to become wealthy into your lives, or you're going to avoid to remain healthy in your lives. Whatever it is, but actually traveling expands your horizons. There's a hadith which I found really interesting. I read a while ago. It said, if one never wants to taste poverty, yeah, if one never wants to taste poverty, they should go for Hajj 3 times. Yeah. Now, you know, it has to have some level of iman there, yeah, because it's $10,000 a trip, right? So you're basically waging $30,000 versus never tasting poverty. You have to have iman for that, yeah? But this is what the hadith tell us, right? And this is something, I mean, the hadith doesn't tell us you're going to be wealthy. It says you're not going to taste poverty, right? And I think that's something that many of us worry about. But one way to get there is by traveling, being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first point that I want us to understand about the adab of safar is that safar is highly recommended. Traveling is highly recommended in Islam. The second reason, or the second adab, is that the purpose of traveling has to be permissible. Okay? So yes, go travel, but they're not saying go travel to anywhere you want to. No, the purpose of that travel has to be permissible. Where you're going has to be a place where your iman is not going to be shattered. Or even if not shattered, a crack will come onto your iman or something like that. According to our sixth Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, he says traveling should be for 3 purposes only. Okay? Traveling should be for 3 purposes only. One, if one is going to get salvation from that travel, right? Now, salvation here means many things, right? So one thing, of course, it would mean spiritual salvation, right? So you go and you spiritually enhance yourself, like going for ziyarat or hajj or umrah. These are places that when we come back, we are uplifted, right? So there is this spiritual salvation that is taking place. But part of that salvation could be something very simple, like physical salvation, meaning rest, right? So I go somewhere, and the purpose of this is that I need to seek rest because of my busy schedule, right? Our schedules are constantly on the go. We're constantly moving. We're constantly chiving forward, right? And sometimes we just need to step back and just relax. Right? Breathe, take it easy. And so that is part of this physical healing or this physical salvation. It could be an ukhrawi salvation. For example, I am preparing my akhirah by going out and volunteering or going out and serving humanity. So that's one of the purposes. And if you just think about that, that opens up the doors for nearly most type of travels, where one can either be seeking physical, spiritual, emotional, or ukhrawi salvation. The second reason the Imam says is to look after the affairs of your economy, your livelihood. That means I travel for work, right? This is an absolutely permissible type of traveling. Obviously, the work has to be halal, but if it is, then that traveling actually is considered to be one of the recommended forms of travel. The third is for recreation. Now, this is really interesting, right? So that's like going to Disney World or something like that, you know? Somewhere where you go for a recreational reason, but provided that it is permissible, right? Now this is something, you know, where now the travel agents will not like me very much, you know? Where we have to be smart in where we go for vacations, okay? We can't just randomly pick a destination, right? And say, oh, Bermuda sounds nice. Yeah, Jamaica sounds nice. Right? Beach resort. Chalo, beach resort, Jasu. Yeah? Baba, you're going to go to a beach resort. You're going to keep your eyes on the ground the whole time? Right? It doesn't make any sense. It really doesn't make any sense. You know, when I'm not trying to be a killjoy, right? But I'm just telling you realities, right? I live by these standards, and alhamdulillah, I have a lot of fun wherever I go. I don't think it's an impossible thing or a task that God is asking, I'm not even asking you, right? The imams say that the purpose of that travel has to be permissible. You know, like I grew up in California, and one of the destinations that could be a very quick overnight vacation would be where? Vegas, yeah? And so we used to go to Vegas, right? So we used to go to Vegas for what purpose? We used to go there, look at the lights, eat some buffet, because they have some excellent buffet in Vegas, and you come back the next day, right? And so this would be normal. And then I heard of a hadith or a story, and I found this story to be very, very fascinating. The story is about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Ma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Where he said that once he went out for trade, and he had a whole caravan, and there was a shorter way to go and a longer way. And he told his trade people that we will go the longer way, right? And they said, you know, you're adding days to the journey, why? And he said that if we had taken a shorter way, we would be passing by the place where the people of either Ad or Thamud received azab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? And he says, I don't want to pass by a place where there was azab of God that had come down, right? Now think about that, right? Places like Vegas, there's not much else going on there except for that which we are not allowed to partake in, right? What's the purpose of going to such a place? When the Prophet would avoid that journey, we're purposely going there. Yeah, that makes no sense. It really makes no sense, right? Like, I don't understand going to a beach resort, for example, right? When I'm going to take my teenage boys and teenage girls with me, and then I'm going to tell them, Baba, don't look while I have difficulty not looking, right? And or I'll let them go and I'll let them participate, and then I'm thinking that that's not going to have an effect on their soul? We can't be that naive, right? We can't be that naive. And so I'm not saying that we shouldn't take vacations, right? Like, again, I'll tell you my own personal thing. Once a year, I like my best to try my best. I shouldn't have given this story, you know? You'd be like, oh, Sheikh takes vacations? Yeah? But we try to rent a villa in Orlando, for example, right? And this villa has a private swimming pool, so my family can go swimming. Everybody's relaxed. It's all secluded. We get our own thing. And our family enjoys the sun and swimming and all of this. And that's something that we do to make sure that it is halalified, for example, right? That's a word. Look it up, dude. Yeah? But basically, we try our best to come up with a program where we try to avoid that which is haram. You know, someone once told me, oh, Sheikh, you're being too harsh. A little bit in moderation is okay. Baba, since when is a little bit of poison allowed? Yeah? Think about that. If I knew something was poison, I'd be like, ah, a sip won't hurt, yaar. Yeah? No, I'd be like, I'm not going to have that, right? Going to places where you know there is a high likelihood of my soul being poisoned, even if it's just a drop of poison, why would we put ourselves in that situation? Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't have fun, right? The travel agents here would know better than me, but there is an entire industry called halal tourism today. Yeah? It's a thriving, if I'm not mistaken, $3 billion industry where you can plan an entire vacation and make it halal. You get your own villa, you get a halal cruise, men swimming on one side, women swimming on the other side. These things are available for us today. Why on earth would we put ourselves in a situation where we would be harming our religion? Y'all understand what I'm saying? There's a hadith that we have from our first Imam Ali alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Where he says, la yakhruj. A man must never go. He said, look, he says, never go. La yakhruj ar-rajulu fi safarin yakhafu fihi ala dinihi wa salatihi. A man or a person must never go on a journey where there is cause to fear over your religion or your prayers. One must never go. Right? Now, this is something that we as individuals and as families need to discuss, right? Next time we go somewhere, let's look at the whole platform. Let's look at where we're going, what we're going, where we're going, right? Even if you go to certain beaches, for example, pick a time of the year when the beach will be empty, when school starts, for example, right? But we're going to go to places where we know it's peak time, everyone's going to be out there. You know, we plan these men retreats every year, right? And one of the discussions came up that let's do it in the summertime, because every time we've gone, the weather has been terrible because we plan away from the summer. And then we said, you know what, we're by a lake, yeah? And if we come here in the summertime, there's going to be all kinds of people swimming out there, and it's not going to be very spiritual. Yeah? It'll actually backfire from what we're trying to do. And so we avoid it, and we get stuck indoors because it's raining or snowing every time. But I think God would prefer that. Yeah? Rather than putting people in situations where there is likelihood that their iman would be harmed. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Ma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. So the purpose has to be permissible. One, we are encouraged to travel. Two, the purpose of the travel has to be permissible. The third is we must prepare before we go. Right? So now before we go, there's a series of preparations one does, right? And it's amazing. I think many of us do the physical preparations, right? We'll pack a list and we'll pack bags and we'll do all of these things. And then if you look at Akhirah, like how much are we preparing similarly for Akhirah going that way, you know? But when it comes for vacations, there are a series of things that we are told we should do. So number one, to take out sadaqah before you leave, okay? So this is something very simple. Right? You take out sadaqah before you leave. Again, there's a tradition supporting this from our sixth imam, As-Sadiq alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Where he says, iftatih safarak bis sadaqah. He says, commence your journey with the giving of charity, giving of sadaqah. Wakhruj idha badalak, and leave when the time seems right. Yeah? Everything at home is in order, everything is packed, everything is ready. Take out sadaqah and leave when the time is right. فَإِنَّكَ تَشْتَرِي سَلَامَةَ سَفَرِكَ Subhanallah. He says, because of that sadaqah, you verily will buy the safety of your journey from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? So simple task. Take out sadaqah next time you travel. Other things, make sure you look into the details of your trip. Right? Not just like, oh, we got to go visit this monument and we got to go. No, look at the religious aspect and prepare religiously for where you are going. So for example, map out or print out the prayer timings of where the destination you're going to. Right? Don't go there and be like, Baba, Fajr ke la aage chahe. Yeah? Zohar ke la. Oh, what time is Zohar? What? Baba, why didn't you know that beforehand? You're going to a place. It's not like you just woke up and were there. Like you clicked your heels and you were there, right? You plan this trip. Plan when prayer timings will be. It's not that hard to do, right? You calculate sunset, add 15 minutes, for example, or 20 minutes. You look at sunrise, you know you have an hour before sunrise to pray. These are not difficult things to do. Look at prayer timings before you go. Know the rules of a traveler, right? Like, okay, I'm traveling. How long will I be there for? Do I pray qasr or do I pray full? Now if I'm praying full, but I'm visiting another place for half a day, do I pray qasr and do I pray? Study these rules, right? I get so many calls, Mulana, do I pray full or qasr now? I'm like, why didn't you look at this before you went, right? Like plan ahead of time. We're smart people, right? God has given us a tremendous intellect. Use it. So plan. Know the rules of traveling. Know how to pray on a plane. Right? What are the rules of praying on a plane? If I'm traveling from here to Turkey, Turkey to Baghdad, what are the rules of praying on a plane? Right? Do I go in the galley and disturb them, or do I pray in my seat, or do I pray somewhere else? If I can't pray somewhere else, can I pray on my seat? If I'm praying on my seat, do I have to stand, or do I have to... Know these rules. They're all available. Mawlana Rizvi has written a booklet on this. Sheikh Hasnain has written a booklet on this. Follow the rules, right? Study them. Islam requires that we study these things. We don't just go in there blind, not knowing anything. Look for halal options when you go there, right? Great website. We all know like Zabiha.com. We've all memorized it, right? Look it up. Put in the postal code. Put in the city. Map out where halal restaurants are, where butcheries are, if you have a place to cook. Don't go there and start scrambling and have to go to places where you might not want to go to eat because they sell alcohol or whatever. Map it out, right? There's a really good website called halaltrip.com, right? I'm sure many of you have used it, halaltrip.com. halaltrip.com. I'm telling you, this halal industry is amazing, right? Halaltrip.com, you go on there, and then there's a drop-down menu where you say prayer timings on the plane, right? And then what you do is, it asks you for your destination, it asks you from where you're leaving, what time you're leaving, where you're arriving to, what time you're arriving, and it will tell you what time will be Fajr, what time will be Dhuhr, and what time will be Maghrib on the plane, and it will give you the Qibla as well. Yeah? So don't call me anymore. Yeah? Halaltrip.com. Okay? That's all I give out. People come out like, go to halaltrip.com. Like, I can't sit there and memorize it and be like, oh, okay, this time you pray two. No, I have to go. You go. Yeah? Halaltrip.com. This is something very easy. But these are simple things that we can do to prepare. Imagine, why am I saying all this, right? When I prepare like this, right? What do you think the message I'm giving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Yeah? That I care about you, God. Yeah? That's why I'm going all of these things to make sure that I don't miss out on anything. Right? That's a tremendous message we give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then there are a litany of supplications, right? Now we're not going to go through all the supplications, but you go to the website duas.org, okay? These are things and websites that we should all be very, very familiar with, right? Duas.org will tell you the dua for exiting and entering the house, for starting the journey, for boarding the means of transportation, for dismounting the means of transportation, for entering a new town, for starting a journey back. All of these things you have, and they're not very long. Don't tire yourself out, right? One, two liners. If you can't do the Arabic, do the English. But just the whole way, you're making sure that God is in your mind and that you are being God conscious. So that's number three. Okay? What was the first one? Highly recommended. Second, from this side. What was number two? One person. Permissible places. And number three, from this side. Plan. Be planners. Yeah? Be people who plan. Now the fourth, while you're on your journey. So we've talked about pre-journey. Now while you are on your journey. While you're on your journey, there has to be one person in charge. Yeah? There has to be. If you're in a group of people, you can't just be like, what do you want to do? I don't know, what do you want to do? I don't know, what do you want to do? Right? No, there has to be one person in charge. There's a hadith again from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Salli ala wa ali Muhammad. He says, إِذَا كَانَ ثَلَاثَةٌ فِي سَفَرٍ فَلْيُؤَمِّرُوا أَحَدَهُمْ. He says that if there are more than three people or three or more people in a journey, one has to be the leader. Yeah? One has to be the leader, right? Now I know you'd be like, I'm the leader, yeah? I'm the alpha guy, right? I'm the leader. Well, the hadith tell us that the one who is the leader is the servant of the group, yeah? So think twice, okay? The hadith says, Sayyidul Qawm Khadimuhum Fis Safar, yeah? The leader of that group is the servant in the travel, in a journey. So if you take the position of leadership, right? You have to be the one who goes out and serves everybody. Make sure everybody's needs are taken care of. It's not that you're leader and then you're a PIO, everybody take care of me. No, it doesn't work like that, right? You take care of others. The third is, be courteous and friendly with those you are traveling with. Man, when you travel with people, you know the truth about people, yeah? You either travel or you live with them. You know, and you really get to know the truth about people. But the expectation is that you conduct yourself in the best of ways and in the best of manners. There's a hadith again from our sixth Imam alayhi salam narrated that Luqman said to his son, Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Where he says, narrated that Luqman said to his son, there's a whole, you know, like there's Surah Luqman and then Luqman gives advice to his son. Ayatollah Ray Shahri, he comes out with a series of books of hadith. Some of them have been translated into English. For example, Mizanul Hikmah, Scales of Wisdom, the abridged version has been translated, but he was the one who compiled it. He has a book that's called, I think it's Mawa'idh or Hikmatul Luqman, an entire book where just Luqman gives advice. You know, and Luqman's advices are very, very beautiful. So this is an advice to his son. He says that when you travel in the company of people, Consult with them frequently about each of your affairs. Make them smile often, and be generous in sharing your provisions with them. When they call you, answer them. And when they ask you for help, assist them. Try to outdo them in three things: long periods of silence, an abundance of prayer, and open-handedness with them with whatever you possess of riding animal, wealth, or food. You be the best person on that trip, right? You imagine if everybody went on a vacation or on ziyarat with the intention that I will not be the one who ruins this vacation, you know? Because we all come back and be like, Olo, oh my God, that guy, I can't believe it. Yeah, and we remember that guy forever, right? Don't be that person. So if we all go in there with the intention that I'm not that person, that journey would just be remarkable, isn't it? And so that's another point. The fourth point, which is also very, very beautiful, that when you go on a journey, bring back something for the family. Yeah? Bring back something for the family. There's a hadith from our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Salli ala Mad wa Ali Muhammad. He says, إِذَا خَرَجَ أَحَدَكُمْ إِلَىٰ سَفَرٍ ثُمَّ قَدِمَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ فَلْيُهُدِيهِمْ فَلْيُطْرِفْهُمْ وَلَوْ حِجَارًا. Yeah, subhanAllah. He says that when you go away on a journey, and upon return to your family, you should bring them back a gift or a novelty, even if it be a mere stone. Yeah, but bring back something, right? Like, think about that, right? Like, if you go on a journey, the stress of the regular house work is lifted for you, of the regular workload and the house is lifted. But your wife, or if your wife travels, your husband and the children, that entire time they're missing you tremendously, right? You may not miss them because you're out having fun somewhere, right? But they're missing you. So come back and bring them something, whatever it is, and it will lighten them up and it will make them happy. And I'm sure, yeah, I'm pretty sure that there is a hadith from Abu Huraira somewhere which says that when you travel, you must bring Sheikh Jafar back something. Yeah? I'm sure. There must be. Yeah? There must be. Yeah? So inshallah, don't forget that as well. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And that's the fourth point, right? And the last point, which is something just to make the number five and to end it very beautifully, that when you come back, right, or even on that journey, reflect, yeah, take notes, or come back and take notes, right? And this will help you in numerous instances, right? It will, for example, in a worldly manner, it will help those who are going to that place. So if someone says, you know, I'm going to Fulan, you'll be like, oh man, let me tell you where to go, let me tell you where not to go, and you give them an entire list, right? It helps you to learn about yourself, that, okay, I had an issue here, how did I solve it? This was difficult, this was something that I wish I hadn't done. So next time you go on this journey, right, you are prepared and you don't make the same mistakes again. Or if it was just a horrible place, right, and you make these notes so that your mind doesn't trick you into going there again and having a terrible time again, right? It happens. You know, you've been to a restaurant, bad experience, you're like, oh, I'm never going there again. And one day you're hungry and you end up at the same restaurant again, right? This happens all the time. So even with journeys or a place, you'd be like, oh, that wasn't fun. But then when you go there or you go somewhere there, you'll end up in the same place. But if you had a list of notes or something to reflect about, you wouldn't make that same mistake again. Just imagine, right? Five simple things we talked about today, right? Five simple things that if we did that entire journey from the time we decided to go till the time we return home would be considered ibadat to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? And I pray inshallah we are able to apply these lessons into our lives. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. We are commemorating the wafat of Umm al-Baneen today. And the story of Umm al-Baneen is one that automatically fills the heart with emotion. You know, they say that when The marriage of Imam Ali and Ummul Baneen took place. The Imam brought Ummul Baneen into his home. And he said to her that tonight, Fatima, is your wedding night. And whatever you desire, I will provide for you. If you desire a new home, I will provide a new home. If you desire a servant, I will provide for you a servant. It is said, Ummul Baneen replied, she said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I only have one request from you. And he says, what is your request, O Fatima? He says, from today, please do not call me Fatima anymore. Yeah, because that name of Fatima in this house might bring an emotional state into the children that I do not want to bear. It is said that when Ummul Baneen gave birth to Abul Fadl al-Abbas, Abbas was presented to Imam alayhi salam, and the khutbah say that when Abbas was placed in the hands of Imam Ali, Imam Ali welled up with tears and he took the little hands of Abbas and he began to kiss them. And tears began to stream down his face. Ummul Baneen inquired, she said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, is there something wrong with the hands of this boy? And the reply came, no, no, Ummul Baneen, these hands will be cut in service to my son Hussein. It is that Ummul Baneen remained in Medina. And when that kafila returned back from Karbala, Imam As-Sajjad alayhi salam requested that that kafila stay outside the city gates of Medina. He sent a poet by the name of Bishr. He said, Bishr, go into Medina and let the people know what the Ummah has done to the grandson of Rasulullah. It is said when Bishr entered and he said to the people of Medina, gather around me, O people of Medina. An elderly lady approached Bishr. She said to him, O Bishr, before you continue, tell me what has happened to my son Hussein. Bishr replied, who are you? She said, Ana Ummul Baneen. I am Ummul Baneen, and tell me what has happened to my son Hussein. Bishr replies, Azam Allahu Ujuraki, Ya Ummul Baneen, Bi Musahabiki, Bi Waladiki, Ja'far. I give you condolences on the death of your son Ja'far. He said, I didn't ask about Ja'far. I'm asking about Hussein. Again, she says, I give you condolences on the death of your son, Abdullah. She said, I didn't ask about Abdullah, O Bishr. Tell me about my son, Hussein. Finally, he says, I give you condolences on the death of your son, Uthman. Again, Ummul Baneen insists. And then finally, he says, I give you condolences, O Ummul Baneen, on the death of your son, Abbas. When she heard that Abbas was no longer alive, she said, I know that Hussein is no longer alive, for Abbas would not leave my son Hussein. فَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّمٌ قَلَبِيًا قَلِبُونَ وَالْآقِبَةٌ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bihaqqi Ummul Baneen to ajjil faraj imam zamanana, that to forgive the sins of our parents and loved ones, for those going through difficulty, that he end their difficulty, for those that have asked us to pray for them, Ya Allah, accept their hajat, for those who are gathered here or listening, Ya Allah, whatever hajat that they have, please fulfill them. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيُّ الْعَلِيمُ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ مَاتَمِ حُسَيْنِ.